I want to talk to you today about shower enclosures. I'm in the middle of doing a bathroom here, a remodel job, and the customer chose to use one of these enclosures, sometimes called an insert, but these remodeling styles come in pieces. So you have a base, which could be a shower, or in this case, or a tub, and you have, you know, two side walls and a back wall. And the reason these are so handy is in a remodeling situation is because they're easy to get through doors. So some of the one-piece units would be a lot more difficult, maybe impossible. These enclosures are nice for a few reasons. Number one, they're easy to clean. So if you have kids especially, you don't have to worry about grout lines and spillage and things like that because you just basically wipe the thing down. They're very inexpensive to buy. And you know, they don't look as nice as tile, I don't think, for the walls, but they certainly are practical. But there is a few things you need to be aware of if you're trying to fit one of these into an existing bath. There's little tolerance, let me just get up here on this ladder, there's little tolerance for differences in width. This particular unit, for example, is a 60-inch unit, right? And from this stud to the stud on the opposite side, the allowed rough opening is only 60 inches to 60 and a quarter inches. But in this particular situation here, my actual rough opening was 60 and a half, and that was in the corners. And then as the wall goes out, it ends up being a lot more than that. So what happened was, to get this wall plumb and level and same on this side, the unit is actually too small for the rough opening. So what can you do? Well, one option would be to choose a smaller unit, say a 4-foot unit instead of a 5-foot unit like I have here, and then build a little wall right here, the correct distance. That's one option. Another option would be to take this wall, which is not framed correctly for the opening, and just reframe the whole wall. But that's very expensive and certainly not in the budget for this remodel job here. So I was faced with the problem of making this thing fit. Well, what I ended up doing was, and this is something you may have to do yourself, is I chose one wall to have the unit flush against, okay? So I chose this side. And then on the other side, I needed to pack out the wall so that it's actually thicker, the wall surface, I should say, is thicker than it would otherwise be. So what I'm doing here, it already had drywall on this side, so I didn't really want to mess with that. This side just did have studs, but, you know, so when I put the unit in, I was going against that. So what I did was I put shims in, and this is all screwed into place. And then I was faced on this side here with about a 1-inch difference from where I needed to be. So I put 1/2 inch of drywall just to match the existing drywall that's already there. And then I took these plywood, you could call them shims, I guess, but they're basically, it's just plywood strips that I screwed into the existing stud locations. And that goes, you know, the full length of the wall. Okay, so anywhere where there's an existing stud, I put in these strips of plywood. So that increases the thickness of the wall by another 1/2 inch. And you can see now that this plywood strip is just about flush with the edge of the flange on the enclosure. So I basically have 1/2 inch drywall, 1/2 inch of plywood, and that equals 1 inch, of course, and that gives me roughly flush where I need to be. Now, the last thing I'll do is put a layer of drywall across this, which will go over this flange, okay, and that'll put me in the correct place. There were some areas up here, for example, if you look on, I was gonna get this shot, but this drywall here, that's just one layer of drywall, is already flush with the corner here, so I'm good. But over on this side, you know, I was 1/2 inch shy where I needed to be, so that's why I packed this out. And then I used shims to kind of taper down where I need to be. So there's a lot of finagling with this, but if you need to pack out a wall, this is kind of what you're going to be faced with. But this also introduces new problems. For example, any electrical outlets or electrical boxes are normally installed so that they're flush with the drywall. But in this case, I needed to bring this out because I'm going to have a new surface plane where the extra drywall will be going. So in this case, I brought the box out as much as I could. It's still not enough, so I'll need to use a box extension, which are available, so that, you know, we don't have these wires exposed in the middle of the wall. So that's one problem. Another problem is the door. Now, a standard door jamb, you have half-inch drywall, 2x4, and another layer of half-inch drywall. But in my case, I'm adding another layer of plywood of half-inch and yet another layer of drywall. So this is going to be much thicker than it would otherwise be. So I needed to take the door out, which I was doing anyway in this case, and I'll have to make custom door jams in order to get this done. So by packing out the wall, I'm solving this problem with the enclosure, but I'm also introducing new problems with the electrical boxes and the door. However, you know, on the other side, my options weren't much better, so I decided that was the best way to go. So these enclosures can be finicky when you're trying to fit them. They're very convenient, they're easy to clean, and they're inexpensive, but they're not as forgiving as, say, a tile wall would be. So that's something to think about as well. So what I'm going to do now is, I've got all this set up, I'll put the last layer of drywall on, and then I'll just cover one more thing while I'm here. Typically, you know, you may see there's different types of drywall, and there's one type called green board, or sometimes it's purple now, where it's designed for moist areas, and you don't see that here. Well, the reason sometimes I will use it, but here I'm not, because I know from experience this is not going to be an issue as far as water up at this height. If it were lower, or if I knew I wasn't using shower doors, then I might be more concerned about it. I will prime this twice after I spackle it. And incidentally, spackle is another way of making up some of the changes in these surfaces. So I'll make sure that's all. Basically, I'll do a skim coat and smooth it out. And then I'll prime it twice, and then I'll put a bead of caulk fairly heavy here. And you'll notice I kept the drywall slightly off the bottom here. So that bead of caulk will fill that area so that moisture can't wick up if anything ever did get up here. But my experience has shown that these shower enclosures, it's 71 inches high, and they usually don't pose a problem as far as water getting up that high. So as long as you paint it well, caulk it well, it's not an issue. And the fact that this bathroom already had standard drywall everywhere else meant that it really wasn't worth it. But if you want to make the extra effort to go with green board or that purple board, there's nothing wrong with that either. So these enclosures can be easy in some ways and finicky in other ways. I find they are useful in certain circumstances, but just be aware that you may have to do some extra work to get them to fit correctly. With the last layer of drywall on, you can see we have a nice flat surface here that goes over the flange, and I did leave a gap here. So after I finish taping and spackling this, there'll be a bead of caulk along here and along the top as well, and that'll protect it from water. There is shower doors going in here, which protect this side from water pretty well. If this were going to be a shower curtain, I probably would have used you know, the green board here, but because I know it's pretty well protected, I know it's not an issue. And if we pull back a little bit, you can see the rest of the installation here. So once I finish taping and spackling and putting a skim coat on here, everything will be smooth and straight and flat, and will be in good shape. I just want to give you the final shot here of the shower enclosure. After I've done some spackling and you're looking at one coat of primer, you can see it's got a much cleaner look to it now. And basically what we're looking at here is the drywall now goes over that flange that was here. I am tight to the side of the shower enclosure, but I will be putting a bead of caulk here, not too thick, but enough to cover that sharp edge. And then I'll put a second prime coat over that and over the rest of the walls. And then it'll be two finish coats. So there'll be quite a lot of paint here protecting the walls. And you'll recall, because I packed out this wall, it's now thicker. So what I had to do was a custom jam, a custom door jam here. So that's actually 5 1/8 or 5 1/4, something like that, versus the standard jam. So I couldn't use a standard door here. After making that custom jam and trimming that out, I'm good to go there. And you'll recall that the light switch was also a problem because the box would be set too far back. So I've put a box extender in, and actually that's spackled in place too. So we're all set there. So after, you know, a little bit of finagling here, I packed out this wall on this side, this wall was flush, and this wall was flush. But it looks good, and you know, looks straight and plumb and everything is as it should be, but there is quite a lot of work when the opening is not exactly what you need. So that's what the shower enclosure looks like, and if you run across this problem in your own remodeling project, now you know what to do.